Welcome to the Equipping You in Grace podcast, hosted by Dave Jenkins. The Equipping You in Grace podcast is a podcast about helping Christians develop a biblical worldview in a conversational tone about issues inside and outside the church. Now, for today's episode, let's join our host, Dave Jenkins.
All right, guys, welcome back to the Equip You in Grace podcast. My name is Dave, and I'm the host for this show. And with me today is our friend and brother in Christ, Scott Aniol. Scott, welcome back to the show, brother.
Thanks so much for having me.
Yeah, man. And I didn't butcher your last name. Sometimes I butcher the ones that I struggle with. So I was really glad for that. But can you catch us up on what's been happening in your life, marriage, ministry, and what are you working on ministry project-wise?
Yeah, so just plugging away here, G3 Ministries, just had our national conference, which went extremely well, about to leave on a UK British Reformation tour, still overseeing all the content and various aspects of the ministry. We just launched G3 Plus about a month ago now, and so that there's a lot of excitement about that, a lot of good resources there. Encourage people to visit plus.g3men.org. And so, yeah, just continuing all of that, working on various projects, some shorter articles and things for upcoming conferences right now, and then hoping to do a book on the Holy Spirit here pretty soon, sort of leading up to our cessationism conference next fall. And all that is being, you know, we released the cessationism film and a book on cessationism by Tom Pennington. And so I think 2024 is going to be the year of the Holy Spirit. So got a book on the Holy Spirit that I'm working on, as well as a co-authored book on the Pentecostalization of evangelical worship. So those are some of the projects I'm working on.
Wow, those are important things. I'm excited to check those out for sure. So can you tell us about this new book, Citizens and Exiles, Christian Faithfulness in God's Two Kingdoms, why you wrote it and how you hope it'll be received?
Yeah, so I've been sort of working in this space for a number of years. Of course, my primary area of scholarship and teaching, you know, I taught 10 years at Southwestern Seminary, is in sort of theology and practice of worship. But inevitably, that gets into areas of culture and contextualization. So even in my PhD dissertation, which was a critical evaluation of the missional church movement and its philosophy of culture and contextualization, I began to dive into sort of two kingdom theology versus neo-Kyperianism. How ought the church to relate to the world? And then teaching there at Southwestern, now at Grace Bible Theological Seminary, inevitably I'm sort of articulating some of those things. And so I would say it was probably 2017-2018, I began to do even a little more work in that area, wrote a couple papers for some conferences for Evangelical Theological Society on these issues. And that work became sort of the seed of this book. And then in 2021, I preached a 5-sermon series in the church where I was an elder in Fort Worth, Texas, kind of dealing with this question of Christian responsibility to the world around us, including family, government, and work. And so that then moved me even further along. And it was then that I decided I wanted to put that in book form, not necessarily as sort of an academic work, but more really to help people to be more of a practical work. So I really started on the book to a certain degree, springboarding off of those 5 sermons in the fall of 21, kind of put it aside for a while to finish some other projects I was working on. And then within the last year, a lot of the discussion about Christian nationalism and those sorts of questions that have been very hot, I decided sort of early this past summer, okay, I just need to finish up this book and use it as an opportunity to lay out in a more thorough fashion my thinking on this issue. Again, mostly for a general lay audience rather than an academic audience.
Yeah. And guys, the book is, that's really good, by the way. The book is well written. It's not only about Christian nationalism, just to clarify. But I mean, you do get into that, but you're very fair in your assessment, and you, as always, you know, want to deal with arguments, and that's one of the things, you know, I can say as a G3 author, you even strengthened my work in that area and helped me realize how I could grow, and you're showing that in this book. And so I really appreciate that, because we need more of that kind of, you know, actual engagement, actual argumentation, rather than, you know, drive-by hitting comment and like, oh, I think this and that, and you're not doing that at all. You're engaging the text and good theology, and yes, you bring in that and you talk about that, but it's not even, you know, just about that. It's about what does Scripture say, like you said, helping the average person, and it's a really helpful book. And it's easy to read.
Yeah, that's good. That's good to know. You're right. I mean, it's not a book about Christian nationalism. And like I mentioned, I really didn't write it or start writing it originally because of that.
Right.
But I do, in the introduction, sort of set that out as one, you know, reason now for laying this out. And I do address it a little bit, but really it is much more of a holistic sort of biblical theology of the nature of God's world in this present age. And so how we as Christians ought to relate to the present age in which we live, both looking back and recognizing God's intention for humankind in the garden, and then also looking forward to the fulfillment and the finalization and consummation of that after Jesus comes again, but all with an eye toward how ought we be living right now. And that's really the question I'm seeking to address.
Yeah, that's really good. What are the three uses of kingdom language in God's plan, and how do they help us understand our relationship to each?
Yeah, that's an important question that I really start with, because I think a lot of Christians, you know, the Bible is filled with kingdom metaphors and kingdom language, king, kingdom, throne, scepter, rule, all that kind of stuff. And I think a lot of Christians assume that when the Bible uses that language, it's all referring to the same exact topic. And then some more thoroughly developed, even theological systems, almost then explicitly argue that. And what I'm trying to help people see is that that's not the case. Sometimes when the Bible uses kingdom language, it's referring to God's sovereign reign over all things. That is a never-changing reality. God has always ruled, He is ruling, and He will always rule. That is always the case. But sometimes the Bible uses that kingdom language, that rule language, to specifically refer to God's people happily submitting to the rule of God. So this intentional spiritual reign of Christ over His redemptive people, which is different than His sovereign rule over the unbelieving world. God sovereignly rules over believers and unbelievers alike, but there's a difference in how He is ruling over His redeemed people, and particularly how His redeemed people are responding to that rule, as opposed to the unbelievers who, whether they acknowledge it or not, they are being ruled by a sovereign God, but of course they reject that. And then there is also language that sort of unites the two. Of God's sovereign rule being then perfectly exerted and exhibited on this earth among all people. And that, I argue in the book, was God's intention from the beginning in the garden, and that will be fully realized through the last Adam, through Jesus Christ, in the kingdom after He returns. But again, that language, that kingdom language is different, although they're all related, but different from God's sovereign rule and different from presently God's rule over His redeemed people. And I'm convinced that a lack of understanding of those distinctions in Scripture is what leads to a lot of confusion regarding the nature of God's rule, what's happening on this earth, and where everything is headed in, you know, in the days and years to come.
Very, very good. Very good. So in light of what you just said, what should our attitude be as Christians in light of the reality of God's two kingdoms?
Yeah. So let me springboard off the last to specifically identify what we're talking about when we say God's two kingdoms. Because there's, you know, I specified three areas where kingdom language is used. So the other thing that I would mention is that when, you know, God intended for his sovereign rule to be perfectly exercised on earth through human kings made in his image. Adam failed in doing that. In the curse upon the serpent, even Adam, God promised that it will come. A seed of the woman, a second Adam, the last Adam, will crush the usurper's head and will rule perfectly as an extension of God's sovereign rule. But during the interim, what God has instituted is common grace institutions by which he sovereignly rules even over the unbelieving people of this world in a manner in which a certain degree of order and peace is maintained, even though the world is cursed and men are sinful. Mm. So when we talk about God's two kingdoms, what we're talking about then is God's sovereign rule over all things through human institutions on earth on the one hand. And so all people are included in that. And those human institutions include things like family and the state. And then the other kingdom, or you could say realm, of God's sovereign rule is what I mentioned earlier, and that is the redemptive rule of God's people. So as Christians, and this is why it's sometimes difficult, we fall in both of those categories. We, of course, fall under the category of Christ's redemptive rule, but at the same time, we also, alongside with every other human being in the world, are part of the common kingdom of this world, again, through which God is sovereignly ruling to protect the peace and order of society. And so as Christians, what I argue in the book is that we need to recognize ourselves as dual citizens. We really fall in both of these categories. As citizens of Christ's redemptive kingdom, we ought to obey every law that God has given us, seek to please God in everything that we do, live out our redemption in every sphere of life. And so that's where it then carries over into the common kingdom of this world. When we participate in those aspects of the common kingdom, which are good, government, family, vocation, all of those things, that's different from the redemptive kingdom. Those things don't redeem. The government doesn't redeem. Family doesn't redeem. Vocation doesn't redeem.
Amen.
Nevertheless, they are good. And as God's chosen redeemed people, we ought to live out our relationship with God through Christ in even those common spheres. So our identity, our primary identity as citizens of the heavenly kingdom, then influences how we act in the realms of the earthly kingdoms of this world, whether it be how we operate in our families, how we vote, how we engage in the public sphere, how we work in our various vocations, all of that, because it's still God's rule, right? It's not two kingdoms like in a yin-yang sense, as if one kingdom is ruled by God and one kingdom is ruled by Satan. No, they are both realms of God's rule. It's just that God has chosen to rule differently over his redeemed people, through his word, under the authority of Christ, and then governed by the church in this age, and then how he rules over all human beings, believers and unbelievers alike, through common grace, human institutions like family and state and vocation. So it's challenging for us as Christians to kind of navigate that. And I think that's where some of the problem lies. But I would argue that much of the New Testament is helping us navigate through that, particularly Peter helps us to navigate through that in his first epistle.
Yeah, that's really, really helpful. Yeah, you just are talking about vocation. What role does a good understanding of vocation help Christians to understand Christian faithfulness?
Yeah, so I think that's one. I devote a whole chapter to this, because that's one area, again, that I think Christians misunderstand, because either we view vocation as something purely secular And so our Christian beliefs and values and faith have nothing to bear on vocation. Or then the flip side of that is where we start to think, well, in order for me to really redeem my vocation, I have to sort of Christianize it. You know, so if I'm a Christian painter, in order to redeem that vocation, I've got to put a Bible verse in every painting. Or if I'm a, you know, whatever it is, a Christian novelist or a Christian, you know, I've somehow got to Christianize it, because in and of itself, it's not Christian. And so I've got to somehow explicitly bring Christianity to bear if I want to bring God glory. And I'm saying, no, human vocation is in that common kingdom. Even when unbelievers work in such a way that how they are working and what they are producing in their vocation is reflective of biblical values, it is good. Now, it's not redeeming, and it is filthy rags in God's sight in terms of what will bring them to forgiveness of sin and eternal life. But nevertheless, it is good work. And so as Christians, we ought to see it that way. And as Christians, we ought to then explicitly see it that way. Unbelievers are not going to explicitly acknowledge that their work that reflects transcendent values of truth, goodness, and beauty is done unto the Lord. They're not, but it is. I mean, if an unbelieving person sells someone a product for a fair wage that improves that person's life, that is a good thing. Again, it's not redemptive, but it is a good thing. As a Christian, I ought to do the same. The difference being, I explicitly understand it to be done unto the glory of God and reflecting of his values as expressed in his general revelation as well as his special revelation. So I think often of, for instance, Colossians chapter 3, in which Paul is articulating how we ought to operate in all of these common grace areas of life: husband, wife, parents, child, employee, employer, or slave and master. And in each of those cases, Paul is helping us as Christians to understand that even in these common everyday aspects of life, we can serve Christ, not in somehow Christianizing it or putting sort of a stamp of Christ on it, or not even in sort of saying, you know, Christ is Lord over this, although we believe that and we should do that. But rather, he tells us how: by working heartily unto the Lord and not just doing it for men. All of those instructions that he gives in Colossians and others of his epistles, Peter deals with this in 1 Peter, tells us how we ought to live as Christians in our human vocations in such a way that God is glorified. And again, it's not just Christianizing it by putting a Christian stamp on it, but it's just working hard, doing all to God's glory, producing things that are fair and that are helpful to people. All of that brings God glory, even in our human vocations.
Yeah, and I think maybe another way to approach this is to ask the other question as well. Like, we know that God places us where he has us, you know, where he has us, like in our vocation. You know, we gather together and then we scatter out. So maybe you could help speak to that a little bit, so that, you know, I think many Christians think, you know, I'm not in, like you even talk about this in the book, I'm not in full-time ministry,
right?
But like, what is that? Like, you were kind of touching on this a little bit when you're in your answer, but, you know, we do gather together, and I know you're going to talk about the gathered church, but then, you know, we scatter from our local churches out into the world. So maybe you could touch on that for the Christian who feels like, you know, my work isn't making a difference wherever that is. If they're a homeschool mom, if they're, you know, a lawyer or a social worker or whatever, what is that? What is that kind of work? How does that benefit, you know, not only people around them, but it's also where the Lord has placed them for, you know, their good and for their growth in grace and to be useful to other people.
Yeah. Again, I think that tendency falls into the trap of assuming that God is only concerned about what happens in his redemptive kingdom. And so if I'm not a pastor or a missionary or doing something within the context of the gathered church, then it's not really valuable in God's eyes. But again, this is where viewing God's realm in two respects, or God's two kingdoms, is so useful, because again, the common kingdom is God's kingdom. It's what he instituted for the good of humankind, not just the good of his people, but in his common grace for the good of even unbelieving people. And so again, this is where, when the New Testament talks about vocation, I mean, I'm struck by Paul's language in Colossians 3, where he is telling slaves that in your vocation, you are serving the Lord Christ. It's not that they're necessarily, you know, preaching the gospel or doing something quote unquote redemptive. No, in just obeying their masters, doing what's expected of them, doing it heartily as unto the Lord, not doing it just to please men, in just doing that, they are serving the Lord Christ. And so I think it's an argument from greater to lesser. If a slave can do that in one of the most mundane, undesirable vocations in this world, how much more can a baker, can a cobbler, can an accountant, can a mechanic serve the Lord Christ through his vocation? I argue you can. Obviously, we want to use opportunities to spread the gospel. We want to do redemptive things, and we should, but just working hard and producing something that helps people in a common grace way, that in and of itself is service to the Lord Christ, and we ought to view it that way.
That's really good. So what is the responsibility of the gathered church?
Yeah, so this is where the distinction is important and necessary. When we gather as the church, we are supposed to do what Christ commanded us to do, no more, no less. And the commission that Christ has given us, articulated well in Matthew chapter 28, is very simply to make disciples. Everything under what the church does as the church must accomplish that particular mission. Now, making disciples is more than just evangelization. It has to start there, has to start with the proclamation of the gospel, but the other modifiers in the Great Commission help to further flesh that out, what it looks like. What does it mean to make a disciple? It means to preach the gospel, see people come to faith. It also means to baptize them, which means join them to the corporate body, and then teach them to observe everything that Christ commanded. So the church has then been authorized by God, commanded by God through Christ to make disciples, which involves teaching the members of the congregation how they ought to be living in the common realms of this world: family, government, vocation, culture. So there is a role that the church has in equipping the people to live in those areas, but the church, as the gathered church, does not have an explicit role regarding the common kingdom, right? So there are two realms, the redemptive realm, and the church is sort of the government of the redemptive realm under the authority of God's written word. And then the common kingdoms, if it's family, right, then the parents have, the father in particular has the government rule over that family. If it's the state, then the human government has the God-ordained jurisdiction over those aspects. And again, Christians ought to be active in those areas, but the church as the church does not have a role in those aspects. Individual Christians do, because again, we are dual citizens. And so this is where it's important to recognize that distinction between these two realms of God's rule and the two jurisdictions that he has appointed during this age over those two different realms of his rule.
That's really good. Really good. Why is a Christian life one of warfare?
Yeah. So I use Paul's language there in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. To talk about the nature of what we as God's redeemed people are really fighting in this age. And that's very important, because Paul is clear that we don't wage war with weapons of the flesh. That's not our warfare. We do fleshly things because we are citizens of the kingdom of this world. So, you know, we have to go out and work to make money to give food to, you know, to feed our families. That is all fleshly. Fleshly doesn't mean bad. It's just of this world, of this earth, of the body. These are all good things. Government has the power of the sword. That is a weapon of the flesh, and it has a role in protecting human life and punishing those who murder. So those are all good things, but that is not where our war as Christians ultimately lies. That's Paul's argument. Mm-hmm. Our war as Christians is a spiritual war. Paul says in Ephesians that we do not battle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, he says what we are fighting against are arguments and lofty opinions raised against the knowledge of Christ. Therefore, our weapons in order to fight the true enemies in the spiritual battle that we have been tasked as in that aspect of Christ's rule. Mm-hmm. So if we want to extend Christ's rule during this present age, it's not flesh, it's not the sword, it's not human means, it's not even human laws or government, as important as that is. None of that is redemptive. None of that is the kind of spiritual battle that is described in the New Testament. Rather, we ought to see our battle as a spiritual battle in which we use divine weapons to destroy strongholds. And what are those strongholds? Again, lofty arguments and opinions raised against the knowledge of God. And so I would argue then that we ought to see ourselves as being in part of a war, but it is a spiritual war. It is not a physical war. It is a spiritual war. And therefore, we use spiritual weapons. And the Bible has given us those weapons. It's what we sometimes call the ordinary means of grace, worship, singing, preaching, scripture reading, prayer, the Lord's Supper, baptism. These are our weapons as we seek to destroy strongholds, which are the lofty opinions raised against Christ. Our war is to bring more people into the redemptive kingdom of Christ. Again, we do physical things, and laws have their place, and government has their place, and the sword has its place, and, you know, parents with children, the rod has its place, and vocation has its place, and all of these things that are good and ordained as part of the common kingdoms of this world. But our ultimate battle is a spiritual battle. And so it's dangerous when we mix the two, because if we begin to define our ultimate battle as in any of these other things, whether it be the rod or human vocation or the government and the sword and laws, then we're not following how Paul describes the nature of our battle there in 2 Corinthians chapter 10.
That's really good. Really good. Why is it important to have our motivation right about how we are to live in society?
Yeah, so this is really the motive for the book. I mean, this is why I wrote it. You know, we ought to value truth for its own sake, and so part of what I'm doing is correcting what I believe to be errors in some ways of thinking. But ultimately, I'm concerned because there are practical ramifications to this as well. And some of them are things like, inevitably, and this is where church history can be really helpful. Inevitably, when we start to make earthly human means the ultimate, or earthly human ends ultimate, like we want to Christianize the society, we want to have a Christian government, we want to enact Christian laws, whatever those things might be. Whenever that happens, inevitably we lose the gospel. Hmm. It never starts that way, but, you know, because usually when it starts, it's people saying, we want to do both. We want to continue to preach the gospel. We recognize that as our mission, but we also need to extend social justice in the world. We need to feed the hungry and clothe the poor. We need to Christianize our society. It starts that way. But if we see those as equivalent, rather than seeing the earthly things as good because of how God intended them to be, not redemptively, but merely at the level of physical, whenever that's happened historically, we end up losing the mission. We lose the gospel. The cart comes before the horse. We start to make, because, and here's one of the reasons why, those things are in a sense more measurable, easier to accomplish actually, and therefore we're attracted to doing those things, when the saving of souls is hard work, particularly saving and discipling. Seeing people grow takes a long time, is hard work, and so we grow impatient. So we've seen this in the West in church history, where people take shortcuts toward what they think are redemptive ends, but they use fleshly means. So take Charlemagne, for example, who baptized pagans at the point of a sword. Well, that was a measurable, observable goal. Look, all of a sudden, you've got baptized members of the church here. And it looks like, man, massive church growth. But he's doing so through fleshly means. Those people did not, of their own volition, put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ and then submit to baptism as a public profession of their faith. So it was measurable. It was observable. It looked good. It looked like society was being Christianized. And again, from an external standpoint, it seemed like it was. That's the nature of Christendom. It has the veneer of Christianity. But at the end of the day, souls were not saved. At the end of the day, you had a lot of nominal Christianity. And at the end of the day, we lost the gospel. We lost the mission of the church. I would argue a lot of this led to the whole church growth, seeker-sensitive movement, because that Christendom model led us into expecting the church or the unbelieving people to come to the church, where they, you know, where we would be able to then bring them in and convert them to Christianity, rather than the New Testament early church practice of going out into the world and spreading the gospel, proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ, seeing people come to faith, and then brought into the church where they are discipled. So that's the biggest danger that I see, that we tend to lose the mission. But there are other ancillary dangers too. I mean, I think if we make the Christianization of society our goal, we're going to be discouraged, because God has never promised that in this age. So we may see short-term wins, but then we have what's happening right now in our society, where things seem to be crumbling, and we get discouraged. You know, we should grieve over that no matter what, but we ought not be discouraged, because we know what Christ is doing in this age. And what he is doing is he's building his church, and nothing is going to stand against that. The gates of hell will not prevail against the building of the church. The building of the church is redemptive. It is the saving of souls. God never promised in this present age societal transformation. He never promised perfect Christian nations ruled by perfect Christian princes. That has been promised. And in fact, it has been ensured in the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension of Christ, but it will not be consummated until Jesus comes again. So I know a lot of people, a lot of Christians who really strongly are working toward wholesale societal transformation, because they believe that is God's intent for this age. And so when it doesn't happen, they get very, very discouraged. And in many cases, they burn out completely because they've been led astray by a false mission. So those are just some of the reasons I think this is important to get right. We don't want to lose our mission of as the church. We want to have a proper understanding of our role in society, in vocation, and so forth. And we want to have confidence in what God has promised will happen in this age, and then what he has promised to happen in the age to come.
Very good, brother. Very good. But where can people go to find out more about you on social media or otherwise?
Yeah, so I'm on Twitter, Scott Aniol, Facebook, same thing, Instagram. I blog at g3min.org. I've got a personal website, scottaniol.com, where I kind of post maybe my more academic articles and books and things. So yeah, you can find me in all those places.
Awesome. Well, just as we wrap up this conversation and land the plane, can you give us a few takeaways, brother?
Yeah, you know, I would just urge people, and I think this is everybody's goal. We want to be biblical. I would just urge people to trust in the sufficiency of what God has given us in his word. And in particular, God has given us in the New Testament a specific expectation and guidelines for how we ought to be living in this age. I'm not saying the Old Testament is not profitable. I'm not saying unhitch from the Old Testament by any stretch, but we need to interpret, we need to have a holistic biblical theology so that we're not pulling out from the Old Testament into the New what God has not prescribed for this age. This age between the first and second coming of Christ has a specific focus that God has given to us as his church. And so I would just urge people, sink yourselves into all of Scripture to understand the nature of what God is doing in his plan in the world. And in particular, sink yourself into the New Testament to understand what we are supposed to doing as the church, how we are supposed to be living as Christians, and then how as Christians we are supposed to be relating to and living in the common kingdoms of this world.
Wonderful, brother. Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for your time today and your work. And guys, Scott's book, if you're watching the video, here is the book. It's called Citizens and Exiles, Christian Faithfulness in God's Two Kingdoms. It's available at G3 Press. I want to encourage you to go ahead and pick it up. Like I said earlier, it's really helpful. It's biblical. It's theologically solid. It's full of practical help. And as you can tell, Scott is a clear thinker, so he's going to help you to think through this. And whether you, you know, agree with the argument or not, at least, you know, you'll understand with the argument, because like I said, Scott is a very clear thinker, and it will give you something to consider from God's word. And so Scott, thank you so much for your time and the work that you're doing and the team is doing at G3. I appreciate all that you guys are doing for God's glory.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me on, and hope people do get the book and read the full argument, and I hope that it's helpful to people.
Amen, brother.
Thank you for listening to the Equipping You in Grace podcast. If you enjoyed it, please subscribe, rate us on the app, and share this with your friends and family on social media. If you want to find us on social media, you can find us on Twitter at Servants of Grace, on Instagram at Servants of Grace, or by searching at Servants of Grace on Facebook. You can also find this episode and many others like it on the front page of our website, servantsofgrace.org.